Welcome back to another episode of Andrew Plays. As always, I'm your host, Andrew Ambrose, and I hope you're having a fantastic day. And it's been a while since I've done one of these, especially with all the stuff that I've been putting out, mainly my chiptune covers. But, I thought it'd be time to do another Andrew Plays. And today's Andrew Plays is a pretty cool one. And in this case, it's Libble Rabble for the Super Famicom. Basically, it's a home port of a 1983 arcade game, originally made by Namco, and was one of their Japan-exclusive arcade titles. And of course, this Super Famicom port is also Japan-exclusive, and it came out in 1994, so this was before Namco started doing the Namco Museum series on the PlayStation. But yeah, this is a pretty cool port of a pretty damn cool arcade game, and I'm gonna play it for you guys today on this episode. But first, like always, we gotta go into the settings and check everything out. And I think I already went through all of these too. I think I already did these dip switch settings earlier. But this is like an early Namco Museum sort of thing where you can go into the actual dip switch settings, which is honestly really cool. But without further ado, let's begin the game, and I'll explain how everything goes. Basically, you got these two arrows. The red one on the left is Libble, and the blue one on the right is Rabble. And what you have to do is you have to move them around these pegs in this board filled with enemies, and take the piece of string between the two of them and wrap them around in order to encase enemies in them. Kind of like kicks, in a sense. Not exactly, but sort of similar like that. It's that sort of ordeal. And you just gotta watch out not to touch any enemies that can kill you. Don't let them touch your arrows. Just try to wrap your little rope around them. And that's the base, and that's pretty much what you do. And of course, there are also little treasure chests that you can reveal that allow you to get extra points. All sorts of stuff you can find in this title. Not to mention, it's also a Namco game with some pretty damn good music. Namco really had a thing for making awesome soundtracks with their games around this time, and I think 83 was really a golden year for their music in their games. Like Mappy, another 83 Namco title, came out the same year as Libble Rabble, and I think it had similar sound hardware, so they really got to do some cool stuff with the music. And appropriately so, they even started making albums for their video game music with arrangements of them, starting in 1986 with Video Game Graffiti Volume 1, which I recommend checking out. It is available online with free downloads. You can find it out there, and it's pretty damn cool. Highly recommended, especially if you're a Namco fan such as myself. Oh yes, I seem to have gotten invincibility, though at the same time, the stage was ended. Oh, also, something interesting. I don't know if the only Super Nintendo game I've done so far on here was International Superstar Soccer Deluxe. I think that was the only one I've done so far besides this one. But basically, for that video, I was using SNES 9X as my Super Nintendo emulator for that video, and that was my main PC emulator for Super Famicom and Super Nintendo titles. But since that video that I made back in August of last year, I've since downloaded BeastNess, that's now my current main emulator for Super Nintendo, and that's actually what I'm using right now. So yeah, I'm using BeastNess today, and going forward for these videos, for whatever Super Nintendo stuff I decide to do. Sorry, that was just my brother. Yeah, BeastNess. The controls in this game, it was a twin-stick arcade game like Robotron 2084 and Crazy Climber, which are also fantastic games that I love so much, coincidentally enough. I don't love Ribble Rabble as much as those other games, but it's still a game I really like. And with this control setup, it can get kind of confusing, because you have to remember, you have to remind yourself which one is the left one and which one is on the right, because sometimes you forget and you accidentally confuse yourself, especially when Libble and Rabble swap places, where Libble's on the right instead of on the left and vice versa. So yeah, you gotta be really careful about stuff like that. And also there's stuff like that where you get swap places like that. There we go. Actually, I think this might be my best game of Libble Rabble ever, but I'm not sure. I think I might have gotten a higher score in the past, but I can't exactly remember. Yeah, like Libble Rabble didn't get that many home ports. Like, the Super Famicom one is, like, the only actual console port. In terms of the other home ports, it's only computers, and in that case, it's the two of the most powerful ones. The FM Towns, and of course, the God computer itself, the Sharp X68000, got a port of this, like, with a lot of other, pretty much all of Namco's other titles from the arcades, got home ports, pretty much, on that computer. Yeah, really, it really stinks that this didn't get that many home ports, and I don't even know if Namco put it in any of their Namco Museum, any of the Namco Museum volumes on PlayStation. And there was a Wii Virtual Console release of this, which I have played before, and it's pretty damn good, especially with the GameCube controller, but of course that was unsurprisingly a Japanese exclusive. Like, with Virtual Console Arcade, Namco put out a ton of their older titles on Virtual Console Arcade, whereas in America only like a few of them came, but in Japan there was all sorts of stuff. Like, they had like your usual ones like Dig Dug and Galaxian and what have you, but also Zevius, obviously. We all know how awesome that game is, and you've already heard it from me a couple times before. But there was also more obscure stuff like Quester and Solvaloo and Starblade. Like, they really did a whole lot of stuff with their Wii Virtual Console Arcade titles, and it was really something beautiful. And it's a shame that only in Japan was this accessible. Yeah, I love the Nintendo Wii. I think it's pretty obvious at this point, but I absolutely love the Wii so much. It's easily, not just because it was my first console and the sentimental value, but in retrospect, and getting to play all these awesome games that I've never played before on it, it truly is one of the best consoles ever made. Like, all the stuff that it had, and all the stuff that it could do, it's like, I love the Switch, but there's a lot of stuff that the Switch isn't doing that I really wish they could. There's a lot of stuff that the Switch isn't doing that the Wii did that I really wish it would do, though thankfully we are getting more of that stuff, and there are a pretty damn good amount of Wii games on the Switch, with improvements, which is pretty awesome. Like, if you're a fan of Xenoblade Chronicles, I'm sure you already have Xenoblade Chronicles Definitive Edition, and there's also Super Mario 3D All-Stars. I played, which has Super Mario Galaxy, and the version of Galaxy in that collection, it is way better than the Wii version, because it's just... It looks beautiful in HD, and not to mention the Joy-Cons work really well, and the pointer controls are even better than on the Wii, because, you know, no sensor bar. It's just... my god. But yeah, the Wii, man. The Wii is where it's at. It may not have had HD, and it may not have been able to play DVDs, at least not without modding. But goddamn it had some fucking awesome games for it, and really, that's all we can ask for from a video game system. Okay, that was a really good score. And I'm gonna try it again. But yeah, I love the Wii so fucking much, dude. And I still have the same Wii I have all those years ago, I still have it after all these years, and it still works. The disc drive doesn't work anymore, but I've been able to compensate by installing homebrew channel and mods for it, and it works like a champion. A beautiful, beautiful champion. I got two of them, little fuzzy dudes, I don't know what they're called, but I think if you get enough of them to spell out the letters up there, you can go to a bonus area. Ooh, I got all of them, in one fell swoop. Jolly good show. Oops. I was hoping I could get that blue guy. The blue guys that cut the rope, they're like the fucking most annoying thing in this game. They also look like one of those enemies from Metroid. They look very similar, actually. I wonder if Nintendo took inspiration from Namco, because they have taken inspiration from them, and they've also worked with them on a good number of stuff. Hell, apparently it was because of Namco that Nintendo started the first-party thing, the third-party licenses with the Famicom. Like, Hudson was the first to put their titles out, but it was Namco that was what gave Nintendo... made Nintendo do it, because, like, Masaya Nakamura wanted to put Famicom games on it, and he even told one of his programmers to reverse engineer it and put Galaxian on there, and of course that was their first Famicom title, followed by Pac-Man, and then from there they just made more. So yeah, Namco, you can thank Namco for a lot of things, and they've done us a lot of good stuff, really. In terms of, like, detrimental things to gaming that I can think of that Namco did, the only one I can really think of, in true honesty, is the fact that they're the ones who put a patent on, who put a patent on having games during loading screens. Like if you've ever played Ridge Racer, you'll notice it has a special little Galaxian minigame on the loading screens. They actually put a patent that prevented anyone else but them from having games during loading screens, and really, that was a detriment, though. Thankfully, people who were crafty enough were able to get around the patent and still do some cool stuff with loading screens, but yeah. Namco really kind of... I don't know what they were thinking. Were they getting greedy? I don't know. I guess it's consolation enough that they're now merged with Bandai, but... whatever. Oh, shit. That guy snipped my thing. I'm dead. He killed me. Fucking those blue dudes. I don't even know what they're called. I know everything in this game has a name, but I don't know what these blue guys are called. I don't think it want to know what. I don't think it would want me to know what it was called. You know what I mean? Shit. You gotta be careful, like, wrapping the rope around those things. It ain't easy, I tell you. I'd forget my head if it wasn't welded to my collarbone. It's kind of stole a line from Real Ghostbusters. But yeah, I think that'll do it for now. That's Libble Rabble, an obscure Namco game from 83, or rather a home port in 94 of a game from 83 from Namco. It's pretty damn good. Gets a bit complicated and definitely quite a challenge, but goddamn it, it's got some pretty damn good music and definitely worth checking out if you can find a way to do so. But yeah, I guess you've heard enough from me. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope to see you next time for whatever else I put out next, be it another Andrew Plays or something else. And as always, thank you everybody for watching. I'm Andrew Ambrose, and I will catch you later.